Dobrý večer, dámy a pánové. Srdečně vás vítáme na dnešním večeru a na debatě k tématu nucených sterilizací. Já se jmenuji Helena Sadílková a ráda bych vás tady přivítala jménem Pražského fóra pro romské dějiny, které celou tuto akci organizuje. Pražské fórum pro romské dějiny sídlí na Ústavu pro soudobé dějiny Akademie věd České republiky a spolupracuje na programu toho fóra se seminářem romistiky na Filozofické fakultě Karlovy univerzity. Dnešní večer se nám podařilo zorganizovat díky podpoře třech institucí, a to je finanční podpora Akademie věd České republiky Strategie 21. Zároveň dost zásadní částku, která nám pomohla tuto akci zorganizovat, jsme získali díky podpoře americké ambasády v České republice a v neposlední řadě nás podpořil fond Isabely a Alfreda Báderových, kterým moc krát děkujeme. Děkujeme zároveň i knihovně Václava Havla za to, že můžeme využít tyto krásné prostory. A já bych teda ráda předala rovnou slovo Janu Grilovi, který bude dnešní debatu moderovat.
Tak, dobrý večer. Jak už Helena uvedla, jmenuji se Jan Gril a budu moderovat tuhle debatu na téma nucená sterilizace romských žen v českém a československém a evropském kontextu. V podstatě jedná se o pokračování celodenního úsilí. První část, vlastně dopoledne a odpoledne, byla více akademicky zaměřená a tahle debata má za cíl nějakým způsobem, trochu dynamičtějším způsobu, otevřít tu diskuzi na téma nucených sterilizací romských žen trošku šířeji. Je to pro mě velkou ctí, že můžu tady diskutovat, nebo spíše předat slovo našim hostům. Jedná se o téma, které si myslím konečně dostává mnohem více prostoru a je velmi důležité podle mě ho diskutovat právě ve vztahu nebo v tom nepoměru, který historicky v podstatě se o něm nemluvilo, nebo bylo to vždycky dost takové tabu, takže jsem velmi rád, že konečně se nám podařilo ve spolupráci s fórem zorganizovat tuto diskuzi a taky vlastně nějakým způsobem zviditelnit dlouhé roky a různé úsilí různých žen, aktivistek, akademiček, které na to téma pracovali, ale v podstatě vždycky to bylo tak trošku rozptýlené a zdá se mi, že poslední roky je to čím dál více koordinovanější a konečně to téma se dostává pozornosti, jaké si skutečně zaslouží. Takže já nebudu zabírat příliš času a přidám slovo našim váženým hostkám. I would also like to invite, welcome all of you who don't speak Czech. There is a bit of difficulty for me because I know some of you don't speak Czech, some of you don't speak English. So just welcome in English to all of you, but I think most of the discussion will be, well, some will be in Czech, you can ask in Czech, you can ask in English, and our guests will be mixing Czech and English, Czech-English. Something like that. Lácho Gives, Savorenge, Nomanes. Mange Pesdel Genane, Igen Butromade, Ale Takamautiste, Tepenen, Lácho Gives, Apaikero, Vashoda, Jetumen Adehinetis, Avian. Takže děkuju a nebudu už dále zdržovat. Chtěl bych představit naše vážené účastnice. Jsem velmi rád, že přijali tu nabídku a pozvání na dnešní večer tady se podělit o své zkušenosti a reflexe. Takže já nejdřív představím všechny, nebo každou zvlášť, a potom předám, bude přibližně ten formát, bude následující. Budeme mít asi tak 10 minut každá z účastnic, budeme nějakou reflexi, trošku takovou prezentaci a potom vlastně po té prezentaci se otevřeme prostě prostor na diskuzi, komentáře, kritiky a tak dále. Jo? Takže představím možná takhle pořadí. Po Melevici je Gwendolyn Albert, Celia Donnert, Elena Gorulová a Angela Koce. Já vždycky před tu následující host, nebo toho, hosta, host, to není host úplně, účastníci představím, takže začneme s paní Elenou Gorulovou. Je nám velkou ctí, že přijal naši nabídku. Paní Gorulová pracuje jako sociální pracovnice v Ostravě, je mluvčí spolku žen poškozených sterilizací v České republice a již velmi let, již přes 13 let, v podstatě bojuje za práva nuceně sterilizovaných žen a mezi různé aktivity a práce, zkušenosti, které měla v minulosti, tak bych zmínil snad, byla členkou Rady vlády pro záležitosti romské komunity a má velmi hodně zkušeností v různých lidskoprávních aktivitách. Takže paní Eleno, děkujeme za pozvání a máte tady 10 minut.
Takže přeji dobrý večer. Trošku mám trému, protože jsem už dlouho nemluvila, ale určitě vidíte, že nemám nic připravené a ráda mluvím vlastně z mých zkušeností, proto si nikdy nic nepřipravuji. Chci asi začít tím, že jsem vlastně jedna z těch žen, která byla nedobrovolně sterilizovaná v roce 1990. Vznik našeho spolku vznikl v roce 2004, ale nebyl to žádný jakoby spolek, vlastně pár organizace, které se spojily a přijeli k nám do Ostravy, jako je Liga lidských práv, Evropské centrum pro práva Romů a podobně, přišlo a zahájilo vlastně s naším panem Kumarem Vyšvanatanem, kde se můžou vyskytovat nějaké ženy, které byly nedobrovolně sterilizované. Takže takový nějaký menší asi pravděpodobně výzkum. Já v tom roce 2004 jsem ještě mezi nima nebyla, protože jsem vůbec o tom nevěděla. Do toho jsem vstoupila až v roce 2005 a to tím, že jsem seděla dlouhodobě doma, neměla jsem co dělat, protože jsem nepracovala, měla jsem dvě děti už a sledovala jsem teletext. Možná někdo to ví na televizi, jak to kdysi bývalo. Možná to ještě je dnes, nevím. A na tom teletextu vlastně bylo, že ženy se někde scházejí a mluví o sterilizaci. A bylo tam psáno, že to je ve vzájemném soužití, která je nezisková organizace. Vůbec jsem nevěděla, co to znamená, nikdy jsem tam nebyla, tak jsem si říkala, že určitě patří mezi nima, protože mně se to stalo taky. Takže jsem navštívila neziskovou organizaci vzájemné soužití, kde se mnou mluvili pracovnice, já jsem jim popsala svůj příběh a podobně. Sepsala jsem s nima nějaký, v té době asi pravděpodobně už se řešilo, že to půjde k obducmanovi, tak jsme vlastně tam sepsali takovou žádost a začala jsem chodit mezi ty ženy. Všecko se to probíhalo právě u toho našeho pána Kumara, kde já vlastně i teď pracuji. A ženy se scházely pravidelně každý pátek jednou v měsíci. Já jsem byla velice ráda, že tam můžu mezi nima být, protože se to jednalo taky i o mě a mohla jsem si s někým o tom hlavně promluvit, co mě vlastně tížilo po celou tu dobu. A za nějakou dobu vlastně ženy se shodly na tom, že by byla potřeba, aby jsme měli nějakou tiskovou mluvčí a podobně. Takže ženy zvolily právě mě. Protože já jsem se snažila co nejvíce vlastně tam chodit, začala jsem telefonovat těm ženám, začala jsem k ním jezdit a podobně, tak ženy vlastně odsouhlasily, že to budu já. Byla jsem velice ráda a věnovala jsem se tomu vlastně v tom vzájemném soužití jako rok dobrovolně. Ty schůzky probíhaly i za podpory tady, kde jsem se vlastně seznámila s Gwendolyn Albert, které je vlastně moje sluníčko a pohony motor. To ještě všechno přijde k tomu. A já jsem vlastně začala telefonovat těm ženám, svolávat ty schůzky, taky někdo k nám docházel, jakoby nějaký host a podobně, jako je například tady pan Pelár, tady Markus Pape taky docházel k nám, jsou tady známé lidi, kteří vlastně přicházeli za námi, s kterýma jsem se setkávala. Nadále jsme vlastně, my ženy se rozhodli, že je potřeba něco jakoby dělat v tom. Jo, že nebudeme jenom o tom mluvit a sedět, ale je potřeba něco dělat. Tak jsme si ujednali nějaké body, s kterýma se budeme zabývat. Hlavně to bylo, aby ten přístup byl jiný, aby ta legislativa se změnila, aby se to už nestávalo jako našim vnučkám, dcerám a podobně. A další bod bylo odškodnění. Takže roky ubíhaly, chodili jsme pořád do toho spolku, pak se nám vyskytlo, že za náma jezdili vlastně média, televize a podobně. Naše ženy měly velice obavy se nejprve ukazovat na kameru, takže byly otočené, fotilo se je prostě nějakým způsobem, aby nebyly vidět. Ale já jsem byla asi možná, nevím jestli jediná, ale začala jsem o tom mluvit veřejně, nebála jsem se, protože se mi to stalo, takže jsem chtěla to vykřičet do celého světa. Tím, že jsem mluvila i já, tak potom ženy postupně taky mluvily a vlastně jsme byli jakoby různě v tisku, média, říkám, i nějaké dokumenty o nás jsou, které se točily, nebylo to lehké, protože média třeba psali o nás, potom byly nějaké kritiky, že to děláme jenom kvůli těm penězům, že jsme romské ženy a podobně. Některé jsme potom měli demonstraci, jsme měli před nemocnici Fifejdy, kde já v té době jsem nebyla s ženami, ale byla jsem vlastně s Gwendolyn Albert, jsme byli vlastně v New Yorku v OSN, kde jsem o tom mluvila. A ostatní byli při demonstraci. Stalo se, že i žena, která vlastně měla v té době nemocensku, nebyla v práci, neměla tam asi pravděpodobně co dělat, je to pravda, ale chtěla se toho zúčastnit, tak v práci za to vyhodili. I takové věci se nám stávaly. Například i to, že kde bydlela další jedna vlastně žen, z žen tak dostala vyhazov z bytu, protože začali oni psát novináři, že vlastně to dělá všecko kvůli těm penězům, sousedi tam byli proti ní a tím se dostala z bytu taky ven. Takže jsme si prošli toho hodně. V té době, jak jsem už říkala, že ty organizace s náma spolupracovaly, tak jsme dostali takový jednorázový foťák a nafotili jsme vlastně nějaké pohledy z domova. Tyto pohledy z domova potom vlastně jsme měli výstavu tady v Praze, v Poslanecké sněmovně, měli jsme to ve Švédsku, měli jsme v Muzeu romské kultury, protože to byla taková putovní výstava. Taky myslím, že to bylo v Chánově. Taky i v Chánově. A vlastně s tou výstavou jsme se vlastně takhle jakoby ukazovali a mluvili o té nedobrovolné sterilizaci. Právě proto si myslím, že ženy u toho, když tohle to prováděli, nebo společně jsme to dělali, tak jsme dokázali hodně. Protože ten přístup se potom v té chvíli nějak změnil za tu dobu. Já to tak říkám, jak kdyby to bylo včera, jako, protože mě to tak všecko teď zrovna jako v té hlavě mám. A začalo vlastně asi ty nemocnice vnímat, že se něco děje, tak ten přístup teďkom už není takový, jaký byl, že nám to, že nám dělali přímo třeba na porodním sále a podobně, nám dávali podepisovat papír k sterilizaci, ale že ta žena vlastně má čas na rozhodnutí, může se s manželem rozhodnout doma, s rodinou a podobně. My jsme tuhle tu možnost neměli. Proto já říkám, že ženy toho dokázaly hodně, protože určitě nikdy si asi neuvědomovali, že něco takového může nastat a že se někde ukážou, že budou o tom mluvit a podobně. V závěru asi můžu říct, jako, já to asi říkám hodně rychle, nevím teda, protože čas asi ubíhá, já se tady podívám, ale chci říct, že vlastně ten boj je dlouhý. Některé ženy vlastně už i umřely. Jo, protože měli nějaké zdravotní potíže, takže nejsou mezi námi, nedožili se toho. A ty zdravotní problémy jsou právě spojené i s tou sterilizací. Nikdy jsme neviděli informovaný souhlas, pak jsem měla možnost chodit po nemocnicích v Moravskoslezském kraji, kde mi byl ukazaný ten informovaný souhlas. Každá nemocnice ho měla jiný. V tom informovaném souhlasu bylo právě to, co ženy teďko mají za problémy, jako klouby, úniku moče, páteř a podobně. S tím se setkáváme všecké ženy, které vlastně tam jsme. Takže já si myslím, že určitě nějaký dopad to má i na ty zdravotní potíže. Co bych řekla dál? V této době vlastně jsme žádné odškodnění nedostali. Dostali jsme jenom takové politování v roce 2009 za dobu vlastně vlády pana Fischera. To bylo jenom takové politování, co se nám stalo, a to bylo vše. Já jsem chodila tady i s Gwen a s různými ostatními, jsme vždycky řešili s někým, z poslanců a podobně, ale nepodařilo se nám vůbec nic. I když už bylo něco vytvořeno, vždycky se vláda zrušilo a jedeme dál. Takže my jsme jakoby ve vlaku a pořád jedeme dál. V dnešní době těch žen, které já znám, je asi přes 200. Jsou to ženy vlastně i z Moravského kraje, jak říkám, takže jsem se s ním setkávala, jako je například v Krnově, kde vlastně jsou rodinka taková žen, které jsou sestry, všechny to bylo provedeno i jejich mamince v tom Krnově právě, takže to je takové zvláštní. Spousta žen mi píše mailem, telefonicky, na Skypeu, tají se mě. Ještě v začátku byly i neromské ženy, chtěla bych říct, ale když mi volali, tak se ptali, prosím vás, kdo chodí do toho spolku? A já jsem říkala, no především romské ženy. Aha, tak to děkuji. Takže vím, že jsou i neromské ženy, ale oni se k nám nechcou připojit. A to je škoda, protože si myslím, že by bylo super, kdyby se připojili k nám. V dnešní době už ty schůzky tak nejsou jako bývaly, protože ve vzájemném soužití, kde já pracuji, tak už pan Kumar taky neměl tolika času a všeho, takže moc se tím nezabýval, tak ty schůzky nejsou už tak pravidelné, jsou méně, ale já to pořád s těma ženama cítím všechno, protože jsme taková rodina, protože oni ví celý život o mně, já o nich, a jak jsem říkala, tak jsme pořád v kontaktu. V kontaktu jsem i vlastně s Gwendolyn, které říkám právě, že to je pohonná hmota moje a moje sluníčko, protože v té době, když jsem točila nějaké dokumenty a podobně, to jsou takové ty dopady, kdy já jsem toho měla strašně moc, protože, jak jsem už říkala, seděla jsem doma strašně dlouho, začala jsem vlastně chodit do školy, na pedagogickou, jakoby si dělat střední školu. Začala jsem pracovat a rodina a všechno. Teď vlastně ty dokumenty točily se mnou různě a podobně, i s manželem. A já jsem vlastně nějakým způsobem, jak bych to řekla, už toho bylo na mě moc, takže jsem musela navštívit psychiatra, odbornou, prostě lékařskou, nějakou psychologa a podobně. Takže 10 let už beru nějaké léky, antidepresiva, protože jsem se úplně zhroutila. Půl roku jsem ležela v lůžku. Rodina moje, můžu říct, trpěla, ale manžel i maminka a tatínek mi hodně v tom pomáhali. Já jsem nechtěla žít, nechtěla jsem nic už dělat, nechtěla jsem nastoupit do té školy a podobně. A pak jsem si teda řekla ne. Já musím stanout a musím, protože to chci. Chtěla jsem dokončit školu a hlavně dokončit můj boj s ženami. Takže vlastně jsem tady, sedím tady, bojuju dál a já jsem ráda, když se mě určitě budete ptát, protože mě to takhle potom ještě všechno přijde. Tak vám moc teda děkuji a děkuji moc, že jsem byla pozvaná, že tady můžu být s vámi a dneska od rána je to strašně s vámi příjemné. Děkuji.
Velmi děkuji paní Gorolové o tuto vzácnou, o podělení se z téhle vzácné zkušenosti, které velmi si vážíme, že se takhle s námi podělíte o tuto zkušenost. A chci pokračovat dál a pozvat Gwendolyn Albert, aby se podělila o to, jaký to je být motorem a sluníčkem. So I would like to welcome Gwendolyn. Gwendolyn je lidskoprávní aktivistka, zaměřující se hlavně na podporu romské komunity. Už mnoho let pracuje převážně tady v Praze, ale vlastně i celosvětově. Je poradkyní pro Radu Evropy, OSCE a OSN v oblasti lidskoprávní problematiky, dotýkající se právě postavení této menšiny v Evropě. od roku 2004. Pracuje s romskými oběťmi nucené sterilizace v České republice, usilujícími o odškodnění za nich spáchané násilí. Účastnila se různých mezinárodních vyjednávání, hlavně ve věci sterilizace s Mezinárodní federací pro gynekologii a porodnictví, které vyústily a vedly úspěšně k revizi jejich základních etických standardů. Také jako aktivistka, která se snaží a usiluje o zohlednění a zviditelnění zkušeností právě romských žen z České republiky, se účastnila různých vyjednávání zahrnující Výbor Vysokého komisaře pro lidská práva, UNAIDS, Program pro rozvoje OSN, UNICEF, Fond pro populace při OSN a Světovou zdravotnickou organizaci. A díky tomuto úsilí a vyjednávání bylo dosaženo formulace společného stanoviska všech těchto nadnárodních organizací a agentur právě v otázce sterilizace a došlo k podpisu dokumentu o eliminaci nucené a nedobrovolné sterilizace. V současné době je členkou dvou pracovních skupin spadajících pod radu vlády, české vlády pro záležitosti romské komunity a také je bývalou členkou Rady české vlády pro lidská práva. Takže to je tak na představení Gwendolyn a jejich bohatých zkušeností a předávám slovo Gwendolyn.
So thank you very much. I will speak my native language, which is English, so I will let you take your headphones on and off. I have prepared a presentation in which I would like to describe just the last 4 years of this activist endeavor to you. And I'm really glad that everybody is here and that we're here together, especially in this particular building, because the first people who ever reported about this to the rest of the world were in fact the people involved with Charter 77. So for me it's especially very meaningful that we're here in this particular location. So let's see if I can do this. Yes. So what is the issue? The issue is that there are thousands of women who remain unredressed throughout the Czech Republic and Slovakia to whom this happened. And there's consensus in the international human rights community and also in the international medical community, as was just mentioned, about the fact that this should not be done, people should not be sterilized without their informed consent, and that when it happens, there should be restitution and redress made for this. Unfortunately, we have not yet succeeded in convincing the Czech state to design an accessible process for all of the women who were sterilized to seek compensation. Technical note, there's a 3-year statute of limitations if such a thing happens to you, during which you are supposed to theoretically get it together to apply for redress through the courts. This means that the vast majority of women to whom this happened do not have any recourse at this moment, and that's why we've been asking the government to design a compensation process that would be direct and not involve the courts. These are abuses that happened beginning in the 20th century and that extended into the 21st century. The last case that we know of was from 2007, which is about 10 years ago. They were understood at the time to be rights violations by the members of Charter 77 who published a series of reports about this. And they spoke about what was going on in terms of genocide because Article 2D of the Genocide Convention says that measures to prevent the reproduction of the members of a group are considered part of the definition of genocide. This, when the efforts that Elena was describing resulted in many of the women coming to the public defender of rights or the ombudsman during the year 2004. And the ombudsman took their reports and asked the Czech Health Ministry for their opinion of the case studies that were submitted to them and then assessed the health ministry's assessment. And there's a basic divergence that has yet to be overcome in the way that the Ministry of Health looks at these cases and the way the Ombudsman sees them. The Ombudsman saw that the consent given was not informed and full in any of the cases that were submitted, but the Health Ministry saw that most of them were just fine and didn't see any problem. And this is a basic conceptual problem that remains and that has yet to be overcome. Basically, violations of human dignity in a medical setting, in a healthcare setting, have to be understood as such, also by the healthcare providers. And this is something that the Special Rapporteur on Torture at the United Nations held a special meeting about in 2013 to investigate the fact that this actually does happen. He did not see this as genocide for a variety of reasons, which we don't have to go into now, but he recommended compensation, and he recommended it with a few caveats that unfortunately I think have kept the process from going forward. There were two basic strands of the way women were sterilized. Some women were offered compensation by social workers. They were misled into agreeing to this in many instances because they were told that it was a reversible procedure, et cetera, where they agreed under pressure or they didn't understand. There were also women who were offered this who understood it and accepted it. Those aren't the women we're concerned with. We're concerned with the women who were coerced and forced. Then there were also parallel cases of women who were being sterilized during, for example, cesarean delivery or abortion or other gynecological procedures where their consent was never sought, or it was sought in advance, or it was sought on the operating table, or under all the different conditions that are described in the Ombudsman's report as not constituting fully informed consent. And those two kinds of forced sterilization ran in parallel. When the incentive was halted in 1991, the cases that involved not social workers, but just simply physicians deciding on their own that this was a good idea and taking advantage of the fact that the woman was there on the operating table to do it. Those kinds of cases continued until the present. And the case from 2007 we know about because it did actually involve sort of a revival of the previous practice, which was that a social worker was again involved in coming to a woman and saying, do this, prove to the state, prove your bona fides to the state, otherwise we're going to take your children away, and that's why she agreed to it. In the Ombudsman's report, he draws a distinction between these two kinds of circumstances under which women were being sterilized. And he says, the women who were sterilized because social workers offered them an incentive should be compensated directly by the state. But the women who were sterilized because the doctors individually decided to do this to them should sue. This is a bit of a false distinction, in my opinion. And also the division in time is artificial. The report mentions it as a division in time. There were, always were cases of women who were also being not treated well by doctors running in parallel with the cases that involved the offering of an incentive. So, but unfortunately, this dichotomy remains in the report, and it's sort of a conundrum for people who read it and are trying to decide how to frame, how should we frame the period during which these women should be allowed to apply for compensation. So previous Czech governments have understood that yes, this would be desirable, including because the international human rights community has reiterated to them over the years that it's desirable. And they have designed compensation schemes but never adopted them, and the most recent one I'll talk about in a minute. In my opinion, it's simply a matter of political courage missing. So in 2014, the Czech Helsinki Committee announced that it had been working on designing a draft bill for the compensation of these women, including its absolutely, you know, its paragrafo ve znění, as they say, the different, how it really should look. If you were to give this to an MP and say, go pass this tomorrow, it would be 98% ready. They announced this, and in the process of those lawyers drafting this legislation, they worked together with Elena and some of the other women on asking them to provide the kinds of medical records that would be available to them should in the future some kind of commission be put together to which these women would then apply. And the women experienced great difficulties during that process when they went to access their own medical records. They were treated rudely, they were charged high amounts of money. It was definitely not a process that was easy for them to get access to their records when their records still existed, because there's a limit on how long records are expected to be kept, and in some cases, the older cases, the records are no longer existing. That was one of the background materials for Human Rights Minister Dean Speer to put together the government's own version of this legislation. And he began to announce in 2014, in March, that they were doing this, that there was a case that had made it all the way to the European Court of Human Rights, and the Czech government was negotiating an out-of-court settlement with the plaintiff, precisely because they don't want to have judgments against the Czech Republic in this matter. Slovakia already has 4 judgments against it in these cases. And Minister Dean Speer told the media and told the women and told the world, we're going to do it, we're going to write this bill, and we're going to, you know, redress this wrong. This was the same year that the interagency statement was issued, which was a result of the international advocacy that I and many, many, many other people have been involved in for quite some time. And the human rights minister began to, later in the year, in August, discuss how much money actually would be involved, that it would be 100,000 crowns, which is at the time, I think something about, 4,000 euro. So everybody believed that this was actually something that was going to happen. These were Czech news agency reports that were going out into the media. And during 2015, the media reported at regular intervals that actually the amount of money under consideration was even more. Now it was going to be 300,000 crowns. There was zero discussion of this being. It was an accepted fact in the way the government was presenting it that this was a harm that should be redressed. That amount is more in line with the amounts that have been awarded by the European Court of Human Rights in the cases in Slovakia where the women were awarded compensation. And then in October, the cabinet rejected the bill after. Media coverage of it, raising everybody's expectations, the women included, the cabinet voted no. Actually, we invested all this time and energy into this, but no, we're not going to adopt it. And the explanation that they gave was that they believed the women should sue, which is, on the face of it, simply doesn't fly. The vast majority of these women, the statute of limitations has expired. And also, it begins to be an almost ahistorical claim to say that women to whom this happened before 1989 should sue. When Elena and the other women that we know to whom this happened previously went to complain to authorities in the relatively recent aftermath after this happened, I can promise you that nobody said to them, oh, that's terrible, go get a lawyer. That is not the reaction that Czechoslovak society had for these women at that time. So this is a disturbing trend, in my opinion, that the government would simply, in a very cavalier, in my opinion, way, say, oh, well, you all should have sued. It's too bad you didn't sue in time. Right away, the Council of Europe, which is the human rights over oversight body. It has 47 member states. All of the EU member states are members of the Council of Europe, and that's the body where the European Court of Human Rights is located. Immediately, the government rejected it on October 1st. On October 2nd, it was raised at the OSCE in the part of the Human Dimension Implementation meeting that was about Roma, thanks in large part to the media activism done by Romea CZ here in the Czech Republic. And then on October 6th, the Council of Europe's Human Rights Commissioner wrote to the government expressing his deep regret that they had claimed that they were going to adopt this law and then failed to do so, and asked why, and noted that there is a guideline on reparations that says that measures must be taken to establish accessible, effective mechanisms, etc. It's all here. And the government sent a response saying that the victims should have sued in time, and arguing that if they didn't sue in time, there's a new finding from the Constitutional Court that says that the courts can waive statutes of limitations in cases of where it would be a violation of dobre mravy, good morals, to insist on them. But there are many legal counter-arguments to that, the main one being that there has to be a principle of legal certainty, and we can just imagine this going around and around and around in the washing machine of the courts forever while the women still keep waiting for this matter to be resolved. And I would just note also that in later that month, the Human Rights Commissioner published the communications that he received from the Czech government, and that is very unusual. They do not normally do that. Very briefly, because I have about 3 minutes, there in 2016, there were a number of developments. Basically, all of the international human rights bodies keep reiterating to the government, please revise your decision, including in the something called the Universal Periodic Review process, which continued, and even the government of the United States called on the Czech Republic during the Universal Periodic Review process to revise its position on the compensation. So there's been sort of relentless nonstop pressure. This year, the advocacy group that works in Slovakia launched an online petition about victims in both the Czech Republic and Slovakia attempting to drum up support for this idea that there should be compensation from the state for these victims. And in March of this year, the Czech justice minister came to Ostrava. He met with the women there. He basically reiterated the state line that everybody should have sued, and it's too bad. And then he said that maybe he would try to get them a meeting with the acting prime minister, and that has not yielded any such thing. What is missing is domestic political will to take this issue on. These women need domestic allies for their cause. They need legislators and lawyers and people who understand this issue and who understand the implications of it for the practice of medicine for everybody in the Czech Republic. And that's what's missing to this day. I'm very, very glad that you are all here, but I think the vast majority of the people in this room are actually people who were at the conference this morning. And this is also an indicator. It's extremely difficult for us to find the domestic allies that we need. And I would be very interested in hearing from any of you if you have any ideas about people in close to positions of decision-making and power who would be able to help us bring this to a successful finish. Thank you.
Many thanks to Gwendolyn for this interesting contribution. So we'll move on. And we'll present the next presenter, will be Celia Donert. I will introduce you in Czech, because yes. Yeah. So Celia je docentkou, nebo přednáší dějiny 20. století na katedře historie na univerzitě v Liverpoolu, Velké Británie. Věnuje se současné evropské historii se zaměřením na sociální historii státního socialismu, hlavně v Československu, sociálních hnutí a historii lidských práv. Minulý rok vydala svoji monografii, první knihu, o sociální historii Romů v Československu ve 20. století jako boji o občanská práva v socialistickém sociálním státě. Je publikovaná v Cambridge University Press, zatím jenom v angličtině a pevně doufám, že bude přeložena do češtiny a všem ji vřele doporučuji, protože si myslím, že se jedná o jednu z nejlepších historických prací na dané téma, na historii, sociální historii romské a romské otázky v Československu. V současné době se věnuje studii nebo výzkumu právům žen a socialistickému internacionalismu. Tento projekt je součástí většího projektu, který je sponzorovaný a podpořen finančně Britskou akademií a Leverhulme Small Grant a Gerda Henkel Stiftung nadací. Od roku 2017 je vedoucí výzkumné sítě HHRC, to je taková britská fundační nadace, bych asi řekl, nebo na téma, v angličtině to přečtu, Research Network on Legacies of the Roma Genocide in Europe since 1945. V podstatě je to výzkumní, taková síť propojení různých výzkumníků zabývajících se vlastně následky nebo důsledky romské genocidy v Evropě z komparativního hlediska po roce 1945, po skončení světové války. Takže nebudu dále zdržovat popisy a předám slovo Celia. Thanks for accepting our invitation. The floor is yours, Celia. Thank you.
So thank you very much for the invitation. It's a real honor to be here. And I think I'll try and keep my comments fairly short. I'm a historian. I'm not an activist, and I'm not involved with compensation claims. But I think the first thing that I wanted to say is just to echo the words in the introduction, and to say how important I think it is that this subject is no longer or is slowly becoming no longer a taboo, and that there can be some kind of open discussion about it. And I mean not only for the contemporary period, but also as a subject that can be discussed and studied as part of Czechoslovak history, but also more broadly as part of European history in the 20th century. And there I just wanted to, you know, say how important I think it is that that the Prague Forum on Romani Histories is supporting an event like this, and to say how strongly I support, you know, the aim of the forum, you know, to make the point that Romani history is a part of European history. It's not something marginal. It's something that can tell us very central questions about the way in which European societies have functioned throughout the 20th century. And why do I think it's important that, in particular, you know, for historians that we study this question of sterilization? Well, most of you were at the workshop this morning. I think what came out really strongly from the discussions was the fact that we need to study this history from multiple perspectives. You know, this is something that concerns the history of science and medicine. We know that sterilization has been a tool of the eugenics movement, not only in Europe but in the United States since the early 20th century. We know it's a very ambivalent history. It's partly about kind of top-down state power, but it's also very much about local level actors. It's about the actions of social workers, it's about the actions of medical professionals, and of course it's very much centrally about the bodies of the men and women who are affected by practices of sterilization. In other contexts, sterilization has been an option as a choice for regulating one's own fertility. But as we heard in the discussions this morning, and as this, I think, came out very clearly from you know, what we've already heard this evening, you know, the central question to bear in mind is this question of power, and who, at what point does the individual involved have the power to make those kind of choices about what happens with their own body? So I think, you know, this is very important to point out. I mean, from my own research, looking at the history of sterilization, well, of the history of state policy towards Roma in socialist Czechoslovakia, which included partly the history of sterilization, two things emerged. One is, as I mentioned, you know, it's as other people have already written about, it's incredibly important to have this, to remember the agency of local level agents of the state, if you want to call them that, but social workers, doctors, so on and so forth. And I think that's particularly important as a historian who's used to having discussions about the nature of communism, you know, that there's been a revival of this idea that communism was some kind of totalitarian system, very top-down, where people didn't have much agency. But I think it's important to remember, you know, that there's a social history from below also. So this is, I think, an important and politically very sensitive point to make. But the other thing I wanted to point out was that, at least from the documents that I looked at, that the question of how to possibly control the fertility of certain parts of the Romani population was a question that was being discussed by various levels of the state administration, going right up to the ministerial level, in the 1960s already. So this is a period that predates the period of time that was covered in the report of the Czech Ombudsman, who mainly focuses on the 1972, the regulation on sterilization and its implementation. But I think, you know, at least from what I saw, this was a question that was being discussed, and I think that has to open up, you know, new avenues of research for how we think about these practices under, you know, various periods of socialist rule. And I think it also brings up this very important question of continuities and discontinuities in these practices across various political regimes in the 20th century and also in countries in various parts of Europe. It's clearly not something that where you can make a clear kind of east-west division. You know, there were various types of welfare state that operated through the 20th century. We may very possibly be witnessing their demise at the moment across Europe. But, you know, I think I don't want to, you know, Gwen raised this question of genocide. And while I don't necessarily want to get into questions of definition, I do very much think that, you know, speaking as a historian, this question of the legacies of the genocide of Roma during the Second World War is still a question that's very much under-researched. And perhaps provocatively, I think I might suggest that, you know, this question of sterilization and interventions into Romani families, into Romani family life, is perhaps one of those areas where, you know, you might see more elements of continuity over the course of the century. And, you know, on the question of compensation struggles, you know, we know that there were struggles to from Romani activists to gain compensation after the Second World War that lasted very, very many years and were incredibly difficult to gain recognition for. It took decades until these questions were, you know, were recognised and addressed. Particularly this idea that, you know, that Roma during the war were persecuted on the basis of race and not on some kind of social, perceived social criteria such as asocial behaviour. So I don't want to speak for too long, but I think that was really what I wanted to say. I think this is hopefully the beginning of a more open discussion about these questions, and a discussion, as Gwendolyn said, that hopefully in the future will bring in a greater variety of people that, you know, so that, you know, these issues can be discussed in, you know, from various perspectives and with everyone having a chance for their voice to be heard. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Celia. Děkuju. Jenom bych chtěl zmínit, že v té nové knize minulého roku ta není přímo o sterilizaci, ale jsou tam na různých částech knize se tomu tématu taky věnuje Celia pro případné zájemce. Dobře, budeme pokračovat. Já si dovolím představit poslední přednášející nebo diskutující, Angela Koce. Angela je přednášející na Středoevropské univerzitě, Central European University in Budapešť. Tam přednáší v rámci programu romských studií a je rovněž akademickou ředitelkou Roma Graduate Preparation Program, což je takový program, které připravuje romské kandidáty na studium, postgraduální studium právě na Středoevropské univerzitě nebo v různých ostatních univerzitách světových. V předchozím období byla hostující přednášející a odbornou asistentkou na katedře sociologie na Wake Forest University, Winston-Salem, Spojených státech, v rámci programu Women, Gender and Sexuality Studies. Byla rovněž hlavní řešitelkou výzkumného projektu mezi roky 2013-2016, který se zabýval institucionalizací romských politik po roce 1989 v Maďarsku, které bylo in English I say institutionalization of Romani politics after 1989 in Hungary, které bylo financované ze strany maďarského výzkumního fondu na sociální věd, pro sociální vědy. Ve svém výzkumu se zabývá průsečíky mezi kategoriemi etnicity, genderu a sociální třídy a sociálních a právních nerovností Romů v různých evropských zemích. Publikovala celou řadu odborných studií, kapitol v různých monografiích, a v roce 2013 byla za svůj interdisciplinární přístup a práci, která právě se snaží kombinovat jednak akademický výzkum, ale jednak více zapojení přímo samotných romských aktérů a aktérek na formování různých politik a spolupodílání se na takzvaném participativním výzkumu, byla oceněna takzvanou Woodrow Wilson International Center Prize for Scholars ve Washingtonu. Ta cena se jmenuje Ion Ratiu Democracy Award. V současné době se snaží dokončit monografii právě o politickém aktivismu a společenském boji romských žen v Evropě, a rovněž připravuje sborník o současné situaci a formování identity Romů jako evropské menšiny. Takže nebudu už dále zdržovat představováním Angely. So Angela, thanks very much for accepting our invitation. The floor is yours.
Thank you. Dobrý večer. Dobrý den. Thank you so much after this generous introduction. So, actually, my heart is really broken after Elena and Gwen report that where we are right now. And because it's, on one hand, it's really great, and we already discussed in this morning that sterilization, it's really become an important issue in the Romani women's movement. But on the other hand, we are still here, hanging in the air, waiting for recognition and reparation. So we are quite bitter And I'm thinking about that, the body and soul report in Slovakia, which first really talked about the systemic sterilization of Romani women. It was published in 2003, and right now we are in 2018, right? So after 15 years, and we are still struggling, and we are still discussing what government should do and how they should compensate Romani women. And in this morning, I was talking about racialization, dehumanization, and sterilization. And we were talking about that in order to come to the point to conduct sterilization, forced sterilization, so people had to be dehumanized and racialized, so they can do whatever they want with them. And usually in Central Eastern Europe, even in an academic discourse as well, we do not really talk about the psychological effect of racism and racialization and dehumanization. And this is a harm, this is a traumatization. And particularly like listening to Elena's, like what happened with all these women, what they went through, and what are the consequences of the sterilization, as well as what are the consequences of many years of struggles and many years of basically not taking them seriously, and this kind of arrogant cynicism, right? What we are witnessing from the governmental part, it's really further traumatizing them. And I was thinking about, like, what should I say after this? And I would like to remind us, you know, that this kind of self-defense mechanisms, what we are doing as a white, middle-class, entitled people. And there is a really tiny book, what I really love. It was written by Greta Quilomba, who is a German Afro-feminist scholar, Plantation Memories. And he's referring to one of the public speech of Paul Gilroy, who is a critical race theory scholar based in UK. And he's talking about actually five different ego defense mechanisms when the white subject, I mean, the whiteness, this kind of superiority, because certainly when we are talking about these cases, it's really involved some kinds of superiority, right? And racial hierarchization. I can do with them because I know better. And also, you know, they are the one whom we can do that. And he's talking about five stages. So the first one is the denial, which operate unconsciously to resolve some kind of emotional conflict. And we saw that. We saw that stage, right? So it's a complete denial and just, you know, reject all kinds of accusation, and it's nothing happened, nothing, why are you talking about? And the second stage is the guilt, when actually people feel that, you know, yes, I it was something, it was a kind of moral infringement, it's a kind of affective state in which one recognized that did something harmful, right? But it's still, you can intellectualize, you can find out some kind of logical justification why you did, right? Because you still don't want to appear in front of the public that actually that was really wrong. And the third stage is the shame, is the fear of ridicule, the response to the failure, and I think that was clearly about that, like all kinds of international pressure, and they don't want to be charged against, right, all kinds of government. They don't want to hear all these kinds of, charge against them, And the fourth one should come with the recognition when recognizes their own whiteness, their own superiority, their own racism, that yes, I did it individually as well as collectively. You know, there is a consensus, there's a silent consensus on white superiority, and it's a kind of process of acknowledgement. And I think at least we are at that stage. There is a process of acknowledgement. It started, and I'm really happy to be here in this public space. I think that's already a symbolic, you know, act that we are doing at the public space, which is accessible for everybody. And this is a process of acknowledgement. And the final should be the reparation. So the negotiation of recognition, repairing the harm caused by racism, by changing structures, agendas, spaces, positions, dynamics, subjective relations, even vocabulary. So changing the vocabulary, the way as we are talking about certain issues, and certainly giving up privileges. It's about that, my dear friends, giving up privileges and sharing our public goods with some other peoples as well. And certainly reparation is not just about money. It's something more. And I just would like to highlight and underline what Gwen told, that, you know, we are looking for local international allies for this cause, and you are that, and we are that. And I'm glad to be here and support you in that. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Köszönöm szépen. Takže já bych teďka si dovolil, nejdřív bych velmi rád poděkoval všem těm tak krásným příspěvkům a teďka bych poprosil vás o otázky, komentáře, kritiky. Můžou to být otázky adresované specificky anebo na někoho, na některou z přednášejících, anebo celkově, aby zareagovali. Můžete se ptát česky. You can also ask in English if you feel more comfortable. There is a translation. Romanes je také možné. Není problém přeložit. Takže bych poprosil, jestli jsou otázky, komentáře.
What occurred to me, and I might just be ignorant that I don't know about this, but what has been the reception within Roma communities of this initiative? Because I've heard a lot about how women have been participating and pushing for this, but what have been the reactions by men or within Roma communities?
Myslíte, jakoby, jestli nás podpořili, nebo mají k tomu, jaký přístup?
Různé reakce.
Takže mezi námi jsou ženy, které se vlastně i rozvedly, protože už nemohly mít další děti, takže některý muž to vlastně nezvládl a rozvedl se s ní. A někteří zase, jako já, například u mě, mě manžel jakoby podpořil, ale první chvíle byly taky těžké, protože měl domnění, že jsem to vlastně tam chtěla já, první, že jsem to jako teda chtěla osobně jako já, takže byly trošku problémy a vlastně to je ostuda. Hlavně to, že to je Rom, chce velkou rodinu a je to ostuda, když vlastně potom někde šel mezi ostatní jakoby chlapi, někde si dají to pivko a podobně, tak určitě na to nějaká reakce přišla. Jo, takže byla to taková potupa pro něho, byl z začátku vlastně jakoby špatně to snášel, ale podpořil mě. To bylo pro mě důležité, protože neumím si představit ostatní ženy, kdyby měly jezdit jakoby do světa A vlastně toho muže nechali doma, protože Romové tohleto moc neznají, aby žena někde jela, mluvila a podobně. Jo? Ale v tom jsem právě viděla, že ten můj manžel mě v tom podpořil, protože jinak by jsem nikam nejela, nemluvila o tom. Takže, ale jsou i ženy, které se vlastně rozvedly a když si našli jiného přítele, tak je vlastně problém to, že s ním nebudou mít nikdy dítě.
May I have a follow-up question to this? And how was the reaction on behalf of Romani organizations, so at political level or organizational representation? Yeah.
This has been fascinating to watch because it's a horribly ugly story that that people don't want to hear. And there's no way to sugarcoat it. There's no way to sugarcoat it. It's just ugly. There are many people who also, I would say, even in the larger women's movement, shy away from this topic because it raises some of the questions about the role, for example, of women who are married and want to negotiate reproduction with their husbands or their life partners. And sometimes what the women would say very often is, you know, I didn't have a chance to discuss it with my partner before this decision was made. And that was already too much for some people to hear. Yeah, they wanted this. There's a real, especially among people, this is my experience, in the reproductive rights movement, a desire to talk about women in isolation from the men with whom they reproduce. So, for example, I gave a presentation about this at a conference that was run by International Planned Parenthood in Bratislava, and it was extremely difficult to convince the women, the otherwise very open, liberal, whatever you want to call them, women who were interested in making information about contraception available to everybody and empowering women to make their own decisions, etc. But to get them to put this on the agenda was much harder than I expected. And it's been the same, really, with the exception of the European Roma Rights Center, which has done the litigation and sees this from a human rights law perspective as something where they can bring cases forward. It actually isn't that easy for people to discuss and talk about and rally around, to my naive and great surprise. I thought, oh, this is so horrible. Certainly we should be able to build up a consensus. Well, the consensus exists in the international human rights community, and that's where it exists. There are women who were sterilized with their informed consent. They knew what they were doing, and they chose sterilization as their birth control option. Already making the distinction between those women and the women who were forced or coerced is already too conceptually difficult for some people, unfortunately. And so, you know, these are very, very complicated matters, actually, that we're trying to discuss and build consensus around. I am continually surprised that the people involved with Romani identity, Romani emancipation, whatever you want to call it, that's been going on here, have not been more supportive of these women. And I think there are a lot of sort of intercultural dynamics going on to which I am completely blind that may have to do with shame or other aspects of this. I can't really answer why people express their support and their understanding for these women and why some don't. But I know that there's also the classist divisions within the Romani community, and there was a horrible, an absolutely horrible documentary that was made about this by Czech television that interspersed discussion of these issues with, for example, a scene of two dogs having sex in a ghetto, where you can see the performance of a Romani woman who believes that she's the good middle class member of society, proudly telling the interviewer, oh, I knew what sterilization was. It didn't bother me when they did it to me. I knew that that's what we should expect. So, you know, we're all each other's keepers and we're all responsible for cultivating the expectations that we have of each other. Today during the workshop we talked about, you know, the internalization of the modern perspective. I am a modern woman because I have engaged with the use of this reproductive control technology. And what's fascinating is if you look at, for example, the case studies that are in the Ombudsman's report, and I really encourage you to all read it because it's just a gold mine. But there are cases there where women were already using contraception. I mean, if the issue was going to be, please don't reproduce anymore, there were women who had IUDs, which, you know, in the 80s was the height of contraceptive methods, who were still being sterilized. Yeah. So there's something else going on here, which is about, and it's Vera Sokolova's work on this is very interesting in my opinion. She writes a lot about how the imaginary example of the oversexed Romani people who are reproducing like crazy and must be controlled. This image was actually being used to control Czech women, to control Slovak women. Don't be like the Roma, be like the, you know, the good average citizen who has the family with 2.5 children or whatever, you know, however it is that we conceptualize these things. I'm babbling way too long now. But what I'm trying to say to you is I don't understand why we don't have more vocal support from many, many, many constituencies, Roma, women, members of the medical profession, who would see clearly that this was wrong and should be redressed. And I don't think this is a society that doesn't understand justice. I don't think that. There are plenty of people who have been redressed here for amazing things. I mean, the whole Třetí odboj, you know, people who were deprived by the state of various goods and therefore now additionally are being restored them. I mean, there's a lot of sophistication here, a lot of sophistication about how to look at the past and deal with it. And in this case, there isn't. And I think that tells us a lot about where we are.
Thank you. Pan Markus Papin.
I just want to...
It is working.
I think this is one of some problems that are quite similar, and for instance, the problem of the pig farm in Leti, many people actually for years knew and repeated themselves. You know, it was actually beginning to be boring, and nobody would understand why this is not solved. And there are other problems, like it took years, decades for government and institutions here to build a monument for the murderers of Mr. Heydrich, you know, because people said, well, Yes, sure, but there are some reasons why we're not very sure that this is a good idea, you know? And so I'm wondering whether we can learn something by other cases. And in the case of Leti, I understood that there was one family of Roma who for 20 years, continuously, every year, made a very small action, actually, but it was continuously supported by the diplomatic corps. And then activists, Czech activists and also from other countries, made some direct action in Leti with blocking cars, which was also looking ridiculous, but it made pictures, images, which were going around in the world. And then there was this EGAM, this European grassroots movement, that was taking these photos or videos to the European Parliament. And then there was this public pressure or international pressure. So I think, do you have any ideas what could kind of improve or enforce this, let's say, movement and to find a new way, a new method to finally kind of realize what everybody wishes to be realized? Thank you.
Thank you, Markus. I think this is a very important point as well. I think this kind of call for building and contributing to forging new solidarities and alliances, because I think one of the main obstacles in these struggles has been that in the traditional Romani activism, this perspective has been quite silent historically, and it's only in recent years or decades that I think even the voices of Romani women activists are becoming more and more heard. And what previously perhaps was rather divisive topic, I think, across communities of Romani, of different Romani activists, I think, this call, I think, is very important. Like, in order to make action political more effective, it's more about building and forging new solidarities. Mm. Okay, another question, please.
Oh,
dobrý. Tak to jedno, můžete, you can start, můžete klidně.
A je zapnut. Mm-hmm. Dobrý večer, já jsem dokumentaristka, zabývám se tématama, které jsou spojeny s Romama. Teďka jsem dodělala film, který se týká mladých, nebo respektive dětí, které vyrostly v romských dětí, převážně, které vyrostly v dětském domově. Já sledovala jsem je pak asi 6 let poté, co ten dětský domov opustili. Film se jmenuje Pasažéři, jsem tady, protože mě to téma zajímá, myslím, sterilizace romských žen, a mám otázku, jestli vlastně nějakým způsobem, nevím, jestli se to dá říct, komunikujete nebo pracujete, nebo kontaktujete lidi, kteří vlastně jsou za to zodpovědní a přímo tyhle ty věci prováděli. Jestli se, jestli by jim nepomohlo nějaké odpuštění ze strany těchhle z těch lidí, kteří jsou za to zodpovědní.
Můžu se zeptat například jakoby zdravotnictví jako lékaři? Tak někteří už nejsou mezi námi. A já například, když jsem vlastně chodila jakoby po nemocnici a dělala jsem rozhovor s personálem, tak jsem se setkala s paní doktorkou, která byla přítomna jako u mého porodu, vlastně potom nastal císařský řez, a ta mi sdělila, že kdyby byla ponaučená jako dnes, tak by se to nestalo. A víte, co jsem chtěla udělat? Chtěla jsem mu doopravdy tam jakoby po ní skočit. Takže ona předtím nevěděla, co dělá, a teď by to věděla, tak taková odpověď, jak já jsem myslela, že fakt jako tam vyskočím na ní. Jo? A já si nemyslím, že ženám by tohle to stačilo, protože já si myslím, že to by byl boj, kdyby takhle seděli naproti ní, jako já jsem seděla, a určitě jsem musela být jakoby v klidu, jo, nemůžu tam vyskakovat, ale říkám, to by byl asi boj, kdyby naproti ním seděla taková doktorka, takhle jim to řekla. Jo, to asi ta omluva by jenom od nich nestačila. Jako nestačila nám ani od vlády ta omluva a nestačí nám. Doopravdy si zasloužíme to odškodnění, si myslím, a že bojujeme už pěkně dlouho. Jako. A s tím personálem, kdy jsem mluvila, tak někteří jako teda sdělili, že u nich se to málo kdy stávalo a podobně, ale měla jsem jedného pana primáře, nebudu jmenovat přímo, v Ostravě, a ten mi sdělil, že ano, souhlasil s tím, že se to dělo, že se to provádělo, jo, ten neměl s tím problémy. Dokonce chodil mezi naše ženy a dělal nám besedy a podobně. Takže si myslím, že záleží teda jako, jak na kom.
Okay, I actually have two comments and questions. One, in the search for other allies, there were two points that came up in the presentations. One was the non-Roma women who were also forcibly sterilized, but who, at the beginning at least, didn't join your movement. And so my question is, have you made any efforts to reach out to such women and have them join you now? First question. Second question, you mentioned this online petition in Slovakia, which was an appeal to the general population to come and support the cause. I was curious about the response to that call, which, you know, is it strong enough to be encouraging or the opposite? And my third question is, how do you see this particular issue in the context of the tremendously inferior health care provided to a large portion of the Roma population, not just with respect to reproduction, but with respect to a whole range of medical problems? And if I'm not overpowering you, the fourth item is, how do you see this issue in relationship to Roma participation in the overall political and election process?
Thank you. So I think this is to any of you. Na kdokoliv nebo kterákoliv z vás se cítí.
On the petition, we should ask Vanda Drobakova if she's happy with the response. My understanding is that it's in the hundreds of people so far. I mean, I have grandiose expectations. I would like to see it be much more supported, but it's not negligible. I think it's on balance a good response, but not a great response is how I would describe it. The issue of healthcare and the way it's progressing as market forces take over here is not something I know enough about to really comment on. So maybe if there's somebody else here in the audience who can comment on that, that would be great. What was the very first question you had?
About the non-Roma victims.
Non-Roma women, yes. Well, yes. There were some non-Romani women who were contacted by the Czech Helsinki Committee and who actually joined us for an event during which the women were interviewed by a very professional moderator. But unfortunately, that material remains with the Czech Helsinki Committee, who has not yet decided what exactly to do with it. And this is part of the problem, what you were talking about, you know, how can we create opportunities for solidarity to be expressed. It's hard to know how to do that. It's hard to know how to create the opportunity where we will then bring forward this information and let it be shown, hopefully, to people who will get the message and carry on. I also think that with respect to Leti, if I could just respond a little bit to Marcus. It's true that, yes, you and I have both been involved in the annual pilgrimage there. But I also personally believe that if Daniel Herman had not been the culture minister, the decision to move the farm would not have been taken. So there's always, you know, you can beat your head against the wall and hopefully one day one of the bricks will be loose. And in the case of Leti, Daniel Herman was the loose brick who let that idea happen. But it's hard to know exactly what to do about this. And I don't know if you, Elena, if you want to talk about, Elena actually ran for parliament. So I don't know if you want to talk about what that was like and what your activism here, how that connected to your decision to accept the offer to run for parliament, or if you want to talk about it. I'm sorry to have spoken for Elena and to reveal that she ran for office, but she did. When it comes to participation, it's a big question. Who feels empowered to say what, when, and where, and to whom? And when you're in a marginalized community, that community has its own rules. And so to negotiate how to come out of that and into the space of the larger society to say something is always going to be difficult. I think that's all I can really say about it.
When mluvila si o čase, kdy se měly ty ženy jako sami bránit a kdy vlastně se měly ozvat kvůli tomu, aby to politici vlastně pochopili. Já vím, že je to těžký přijít domů z nemocnice, oznámit to rodině, co se mi stalo. Vím, jaký to je a pochopím ty ženy, jak v tom asi všechno, jak to v nich produkovalo a co se v nich dělo. A právě jsem se chtěla zeptat, jestli ten čas, kdy politici chtějí, aby se ženy začaly bránit, kdy je ten pravý čas? Jestli to ten politik, co jsi s ním mluvila, vlastně pochopil, že to není lehká záležitost. A právě když řekne, aby s tím něco dělali už dřív, tak kdy je to zase dřív?
I agree, yes. When is the ideal time? The degree to which the women who suffered this have been subjected to total incomprehension, very undignified responses, real lack of empathy, really sort of a cold approach to this is amazing. It's amazing. We had a meeting, there was a meeting with the working group on this issue that advises the Council on Roma Affairs, where, you know, the lawyers from the health ministry had no problem coming, and even with Ms. Gorolova sitting right there, saying that in their opinion, this is, you know, just medical malpractice of the same kind as if someone operated on the wrong foot or something in a hospital. At the absolute incomprehension that what has happened to them is not just that, you know, someone did something to their fallopian tubes that they didn't want, but that their personhood, their soul, I don't know what else to call it, their personhood has been violated. Their dignity has been violated. You don't do this to people. We do this to animals without asking them. Yeah? Dogs and cats that we don't want to have 9 million children or little puppies running around. We don't do this to people, not to our fellow human beings. But it happened here. So I don't know what to say other than that there's a kind of, I don't want to believe that it's the case that you have to be in some very privileged position to have the luxury of feeling other people's pain, because it seems to me that it's very often people in positions of privilege who feel nothing. This is why they perpetrate what they perpetrate. But it does seem to me that it's not so easy to find people who really understand, like in their hearts, what has happened to these women. And that's just, I mean, I'm sorry to keep telling you bad news, but that's, I think that's where we are, that there's a real, like, you know, Angela said that her heart was broken to hear this. And what I find amazing is that there are more people who can listen to this and feel absolutely nothing. Elena did try. I don't know if you want to talk about in the immediate aftermath of this, when you went to the authorities and what your experience was.
Tak jak jsem říkala, že v roce 1990 se mi to stalo, tak vlastně, když jsem přišla domů, tak jsem šla na úřad, to bylo jakoby po komunistické, že v to 90. roce, a vlastně jsem se ptala, jako, protože některé ženy, když jsem potkala, tak mi říkali, že oni vlastně něco za to dostali a podobně, ale já jsem se chtěla zeptat důvod, jo, proč mi to bylo vlastně provedeno, a taky jsem se ptala na ty finance. No a co mi udělali na úřadě? Vzali mě a vyhodili mě ven. To bylo všechno, co mohli dokázat a udělat, takže od té doby potom jsem za nikým nešla, s nikým o tom nemohla mluvit, nic. A nevěděla jsem, kdyby fakt tato možnost byla, určitě by proto něco udělala, ale nevěděla jsem, neměla jsem od koho. Jak říkám, já jsem dlouhodobě nepracovala, byla jsem doma s dětmi a možná nevím, jestli to tak, jako prostě v takové lokalitě jsem bydlela, jo, kde doopravdy samé Romové, nevím, jestli ta kauze znáte, před nádraží, kde jsem bydlela, jo, takže jsem se starala jenom o děti, vlastně o domácnost, manžela a to, jo, neměla jsem to kde slyšet. A v rodině, když jsem se ptala i naše babičky, ta mi nedokázala taky ani říct o sterilizaci, protože nikdy to neslyšela, když porodila nějakých 13 dětí a vůbec žádná sterilizace neexistovala. A já jsem ještě vlastně chodila do rizikové poradny, tak já si myslím, že v té rizikové poradně mi to měli sdělit, co může přijít, když věděli, že vlastně proto tam chodím, protože jsem měla první jakoby císařský řez, protože byl napříč, jo, tak už mi mohli vlastně sdělit a připravit mě na to, že může tata situace nastanout. Tak dobře, v pořádku, když jste mě na to připravili, dobře, já se doma rozmyslím s manželem, to je pro mě důležité, protože jsou na to dva lidi a je tam ten manžel, jo, tak my se dohodneme a kvůli mojemu zdravotnímu stavu a kvůli našim dětem to podstoupím, ale vím, že jsem to podstoupila, že jsem to podepsala a jsem si toho vědoma. Ale tak, jak mi to bylo provedeno mně, taky jakoby vlastně, kdy při tím druhým nastaly porodní bolesti, začal velký problém, protože mi vyletěla pupeční šňůra a musel nastat druhý císařský řez. A v té chvíli absolutně nechápu, jak by mohla druhá jakoby to nepodepsat. Donesli mi dva papíry, na jednom stálo jméno holčičky nebo chlapečka, na druhé o sterilizaci. Podepsala jsem a za chvilku jsem byla na sále, probudila jsem se, nevěděla jsem vůbec nic. A když tam přišel ještě můj manžel a ptal se, co mi provedli, no a když začal tam vlastně dělat kravala podobně, tak chtěli na něho zavolat policii. Ale on měl být jakoby přítomen a vědět o tom. To mě nejvíce, s prominutím řeknu na to tady, štve, jinak by do toho nikdy nešla. Ale to mě štve, bylo mi 21 let. Jsem ráda, že mám dva syny, jo, ale vždycky s manželem jsme si přali holčičku. A já mám manžela z dětského domova. Ten měl život velice špatný, takže on chtěl větší rodinu. Neříkám, že by jich měla tucet, ale možná o to jedno dítě ještě jsem třeba měla. Takže tohle to mě prostě nepřestane, abych nebojovala. Budu bojovat nadále s těma ženama a nepřestane, protože i když už teď mi bude 50 let, pořád to ve mně je. A kdyby měla fakt sedět naproti těch dalších nějakých lékařů a podobně, tak já se vždycky rozčilím a podobně. A ještě jsem chtěla jenom podotknout, co se týče, jakoby, když tady Gwen říkala o té vládě a podobně. Jo? Já jsem byla taky členkou rady vlády. Neustále se o tom mluvilo a nic se nedělo. Mezi námi přišla dokonce bývalá ministryně školství Kateřina Valachová, která s ženami mluvila, slibovala hory doly a nakonec byla i ta, která vlastně zvedla ruku proti tomu. Takže potom, jak ty ženy se mají cítit? když přijde někdo, taková osobnost pro ně, protože v životě by se nesetkali s takovým člověkem, takže věří. Oni věří tomu, kdo za náma přijde a chce nám pomoci. A když je tak zklamé, tak oni někdy už i ten boj je přestává bavit jako mě. A proto jsem řekla, že Gwen je ten pohonný motor, protože když jsem byla v konci, tak jsem volala jedině Gwen a zase opět dál. A já jí chci tady tím strašně poděkovat a opět mi jdou slzy do očí, protože pokaždé, když o tom budu mluvit, pokaždé ty slzy budu mít a jsem prostě mám v sobě takový vztek, jako, že nikdo nám nechce věřit. A jako říkáme, tak jak tady se říká, nějaké fotografie, vždyť já tam jdu, vždyť to jsem já, které se to stalo. Vždyť mě vidí ty lidi. Vždyť to není normální tady tohleto, vždyť to mluvím já ze svého srdce. To mluvím přece. Děkuju a jsem opět taková.
Rád bych se zeptal, jestli víte, kde máme ty spojence hledat. Jestli máte nějakou ideu, protože proto tady jsme.
Já si myslím, že nejdůležitější bude... Oh, sorry. I think the most important thing will be to have, if we could organize a member of the government and some people in the parliament to agree that they will put the law together and that they will submit it to the parliament and that they will lobby for it to be passed. And this is the problem, that this really does become a political question and parliament will have to vote on it. I don't know that the government has a way that they could do it without having to ask parliament. Probably not. If there was a technical way to do that, that might be even better. Or maybe they could keep it in the secret negotiation regime like they did with the Leti, the amount of money that was promised to be spent to remove the pig farm from Leti. But people who know how to play that machine, the machine that is the government and the laws, that's who we need. That's who we need. And I don't think it has to be an enormous group of people. Just people who know what they're doing and people who have the heart to empathize with Elena and everybody else. And this is a small place. There's only 10 million people here. I'm sure we can find them. I'm sure we can find them. I do believe that there are people who understand this here. But I don't know everybody.
It's hard to pick up on something that was previously said, because this is a really dramatic discussion right now. I want to refer back to a question that you posed with regard to the health of Roma. So you asked something about what do we know or what has been done about the horrible things that Roma face in the healthcare system. I just want to... I'm not sure if you have anything specific on mind besides this issue, because one of the misconceptions that a lot of people have about Romani health is that, in the Czech Republic specifically, is that Roma don't have sufficient physical access to health services. I just want to point out that this is not the case, that statistically Roma overuse health services in terms of going to the doctor more often than non-Roma. It's just that they're not so much involved in preventive care. So the health-seeking behavior is different. So there's a lot to be done on this. And also we know that they live 10 years shorter on average than non-Roma do. So there's a really large gap that is not really explained by research at this point.
Well, I think this could be a subject of a whole other debate. I'm basing my comments on research by Charles University, someone in Charles University that I have at home. The life expectancy difference that's cited there is 15 years. There are all kinds of financial issues involved, where the doctors will prescribe state-of-the-art medications, which are beyond the financial capabilities of the families to buy, so that instead of taking a generic or less state-of-the-art medication, no medication is taken. I brought up the issue only because I got the impression that this is what is called a niche issue of the forced sterilization, and I wanted to get the ideas of the panel, how it relates to the larger context of poor health care, let's put it that way. No matter how many times people show up, it's poor health care, and this is a reflection of that.
Would any of you like to answer or chcete odpovědět na nebo komentovat? Ne?
No. No, actually something else is going on in my mind. I'm still thinking about that. Like, how can we... I'm sorry that I'm not addressing specifically this question because I'm really stuck in the other moment. So how can we build up some allies and what can we do? And I'm thinking about that there is this European Women's Lobby, which is an umbrella organization, you know, and consists of many national women's organizations. There are various influential women's there. So why don't we ask them to organize something and go to the Czech embassy and Slovak embassy in every country, all the women's, Roma and non-Roma women's, together with kids or whatever they're going to find at home and protest. And claim justice and claim for recognition and reparation of Romani women. So I really would be happy to, you know, do something on this front. And I think we should do it. I mean, it cannot be like just that.
Děkuji, thank you. Questions, comments to follow up? Or if any of you would like to also respond to other questions or... Any thoughts? Katka? Mm-hmm.
Já mám dotaz na sílí. Do jaké míry vidíš kontinuitu do té současnosti právě ještě z komunistického Československa, kde vlastně dochází k takovému propojení na jednu stranu Romové jako... etnická skupina, že to je vlastně taková a někdy i často i rasové hledisko, a na druhou stranu zrovna při tom boji o kompenzaci romských žen, které byly sterilizované, se tam objevuje často naopak ten pohled, že to je vlastně spíše sociální skupina, že vlastně ta sterilizace romských žen vlastně není stejné téma jako třeba sterilizace neromských žen. Takže vlastně taková podivná kombinace dvou definic Romů, která vlastně vždycky vylučuje tu možnost právě toho nějakého právního boje.
I think that, yeah, I mean, obviously there have been greater opportunities to identify. I feel less comfortable talking about more recent developments, but I think that, you know, yeah, probably I would see, you know, continuities in some degree, but I mean, clearly there have been, you know, in the post-socialist period, for example, I mean, the opportunity to identify on the basis of ethnicity or culture has been much greater, but you know, I would maybe see more continuity in perhaps people's reluctance to do that for all sorts of structural reasons, which have to do with, you know, this sort of external definition, you know, based on social criteria. But as I said, I think probably somebody like Gwen would be much better placed to talk about, you know, those continuities. Yeah. I think another big difference is, or I don't know about a difference, but in terms of recent developments, this capacity, which, you know, as we heard, started from, you know, the framing of this issue in terms of kind of rights violations and the different, you know, the different levels at which people can kind of claim recognition. You know, I think this is a huge, you know, the fact that there are kind of, there is an international audience. So in that sense, this is not directly relevant to your question, but, you know, these sort of questions about how maybe people involved in this struggle for compensation could to look at other, you know, questions that have kind of attracted a lot of international attention, such as Leti. But as I said, I feel, you know, I feel less comfortable talking about kind of contemporary developments, if I've understood your question properly.
Dobře, děkuji vám. Thank you very much. Unfortunately, the time is up. Kvůli časovým důvodům já si dovolím ukončit teďka tu debatu. Chtěl bych jenom vyjádřit velké díky vám všem, co jste přišli a participovali jste na diskuzi a podělili se s námi o váš čas. Rovněž bych si chtěl dovolit poděkovat Kateřině Čapkové a Heleně Sadílkové, které byly hlavními motory jednak toho akademického a i tohohle toho více otevřeného setkání a této diskuze. Takže velké díky a hlavně a především bych chtěl poděkovat našim hostům, který rádi přijali, jsme velmi si vážíme vašich pohledů a té diskuze. So many thanks to all of you for your participation. Vajkerov Šukárest. And yeah, that's it. Děkujeme.